Thank you. Could I ask those who are leaving the chamber to please do so quickly and quietly, as we are now going to turn to our final item of business. And the final item of business is a member's business debate on motion 11980 in the name of Stuart McMillan on McClure solicitors. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and I would invite those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons, and I call on Stuart McMillan to open the debate. Around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, President Gosling. First, I want to thank MSPs from across the chamber for supporting the motion to allow it to be debated today. And before getting into the substantive points of the motion, I want to give some background as to how my office became so heavily involved in this particular matter. And as we know, McClure solicitors were founded in Greenock in 1853, went into administration in 2021. Glasgow-based firm Jones & White then took on roughly 100,000 matters McClure's had on their books. Some people had multiple matters. This meant that anyone needing to gain access to their documents would need to contact Jones & White. They can choose to stay with Jones & White, or they can choose to go to any solicitor of their choice. Now, when McClure's ceased trading, there wasn't really a vast amount of press coverage to read, particularly how this would impact former clients. And this did occur during the COVID-19 pandemic, and I believe that 84 jobs were secured when Jones & White took over the goodwill, work in progress and certain assets of McClure's, including all wills, the power of attorneys and trusts. So while being aware that McClure's was no more, it was not something that gained much by way of news coverage or generated a lot of emails into my inbox. This changed as of last summer. I started to see a growing number of people contacting the office, likely spurred on by the growing knowledge of the firm going out of business, and more national news coverage, specifically from Katie Hunter at BBC Scotland, and also more and more people with trusts receiving letters from Jones & White. I understand from discussions with Jones & White that whilst there may quite rightly be an expectation that former McClure's clients should have been notified by now, but they simply aren't able to do this en masse, and they're making their way through the files as quickly as they can, focusing on trusts in the first instance. They were clear, however, that anyone who has business with McClure's should contact them, and they will do all they can to help. And once again, for clarity, there is no requirement for former McClure's clients to use Jones & White services going forward. If they do wish for their documents to be reviewed, they can instruct Jones & White to do so, or they can ask for their documents to be returned to them for another lawyer of their choice. As I learned more about the issue, I arranged meetings with interested parties, including the Law Society of Scotland, the Scottish Legal Complaints Commission, and also the Minister. And I've spoken to several solicitors and many constituents. And I'd like to put on record my thanks to the SLCC and their Chief Executive, Neil Stevenson, for engaging with my office as I attempted to assist affected constituents. Neil attended two public meetings I held in my Greenock and Inverclyde constituency to explain to former McClure clients what the SLCC can and cannot do regarding any support or redress. And the first event I hosted sold out, and due to the level of contact I was receiving from constituents, it became clear that another one was required. So across two meetings, over 270 constituents gained a seat to put questions directly to the SLCC and myself. And after the last meeting, I've had requests to do a third meeting with lawyers present to answer legal questions. Now, I am working through the legal ramifications and also the risks of doing this. Now, while both meetings were for former McClure's clients, they were not specifically to discuss McClure solicitors, but to provide information about the main route they have for recourse if they believe they have a complaint to make about either McClure, its staff or any other lawyer. Also, I know some of my constituents have already had complaints upheld by the SLCC and compensation awarded, which is why I've been so keen to raise awareness of this issue. It's also why I was keen to secure a members' debate, as I'm aware that it's not only my constituents who are affected by this. I've no doubt there will be former McClure's clients who will only be finding out about the firm closing down whilst watching either this debate or from any subsequent press that happens from it. Also, it's clear something went very wrong at McClure solicitors, and that's why we are here today. Thousands of people across the UK spent significant sums of money with McClure, with the expectation being that they would not have to pay for any legal work like this again. For many, this will not be the reality. Thousands of people are now having to spend additional sums of money having McClure partners removed from their trusts. And whilst I understand this may involve a cost to the trustee who has been removed, I would ask them all if morally they should be taking a fee. I also understand that there is nothing wrong at all with solicitors being named on trusts as trustees. However, I believe it's more commonplace for a law firm itself to be named on the trust as opposed to individual lawyers. Now, if that were the case with McClure, and again, I believe they did start to do this in later years, more people may be in a different situation today. I want to turn now to what can be done going forward. The suggestion by a constituent at the second public meeting was for the Scottish Government to create an organisation to review people's documentation to help them determine what action, if any, to take next. Now, most people are not legally trained and have already spent many hundreds, if not thousands, of pounds on documentation that may or may not be fit for purpose. Now, I think this is a welcome idea, but I don't know where the solicitors would come from to staff such a body, as trust lawyers are specialised and most would already be in employment, and those in training may not possess the relevant expertise, and some who are retired may not want to get involved. But if the Scottish Government could give it some consideration, I know it certainly would be appreciated. Now, secondly, I believe an inquiry should be held in the future. I know some MSPs have echoed this call. And I want to be clear, however, that I don't think an inquiry at this point would be beneficial, because the current focus must be on helping people. The fact that not every trust will have been reviewed indicates to me that any inquiry in the short term would be premature. It would also deviate time from solicitors who are dealing with many of the McClure's cases that otherwise would be spent on helping people now. And that said, we do need an inquiry to be held in the future to drill down what happened at McClure's leading up to the administration. Not a fishing expedition that looks at everything and anything, but a focused inquiry. I've had constituents making many, many claims about their documentation, including, and I've just got a very short list here, powers of attorney were not lodged with the Office of Public Guardian despite the work being paid for, trusts were in the wrong name or other details were wrong, or they weren't properly advised as to what a trust is, why they might want one, and what the implications for them were going forward. And some have even suggested trusts may have been set up for relatives who lack capacity, and trusts have not been registered appropriately with HMRC and the Land Register of Scotland. The reviewing of the documents is therefore vital in terms of substantiating or not these claims ahead of any inquiry. I accept we can't pass legislation retrospectively to fix past issues, but we can, however, learn from it. And the Government has already introduced bills before the Parliament, including the Trust Succession Scotland Bill, which was passed in December, the Regulation Legal Services Scotland Bill, which passed Stage 1 last week, and the Judicial Factors Scotland Bill, which the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee will be scrutinising from late April. Now, these bills are important as they will strengthen the regulatory regime that law firms operate within. However, as I indicated last week in the legal regulation debate, I believe that an inquiry into what happened in McClure's will ultimately lead to more lessons being learned and potentially further reform. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, during my 17 years as an MSP, no other single issue has dominated my caseload and my inbox like this particular issue. Thousands of my constituents are affected, and also many, many more UK-wide. And I will certainly continue to do whatever I can for my constituents, and I would encourage anyone who has been affected to contact their MSP or MP if they live elsewhere in the UK. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr McMillan. I would remind those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please check that they have pressed their request to speak buttons. And I call, move to the open debate, I call Fulton MacGregor to be followed by Russell Finlay. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr MacGregor.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I start by thanking Stuart McMillan for bringing this important debate into the Chamber. I know he's put a lot of work into organising information evenings and been a strong advocate for those who have been affected by this issue. And I think we all heard tonight the huge number of cases that he has been dealing with. I'd also like to thank my other colleague, Bob Dorris, who's also engaged a lot in this issue and hosted a well-attended event here in Parliament last November. And both the information from his and Stuart McMillan's events have been invaluable in helping my understanding of the sheer scale of the issue at hand. Constituents first came to my office regarding McClure's in 2021. In many cases, they'd not been informed that McClure's had actually gone into administration and had only found out by chance that their trust had been passed on to Jones and White. To add to their uncertainty, my constituents were advised that there were systemic issues with some of the trusts. In order to examine these trusts, fees upwards of £300 were quoted before any information could be disclosed. These costs, coupled with the uncertainty and lack of communication, have caused intense stress for my constituents and their families. In many cases, those affected are now in their mid-70s or even older. For those who are indeed elderly, there are many who are now incapacitated, and it has fallen to their families who are trying to work through this confusion. One such example of this is with two of my constituents who were happy to be named in the chamber today. My office did phone and check with them. Pamela and Bob Adams visited my office recently to underline the level of stress that they have experienced trying to navigate the legal labyrinth and trying to get clarity on a family protection trust and power of attorney registration established for Pamela's mother. And I'm very grateful to them for sharing their story and allowing me to better understand the real impact on real people. With approximately 100,000 affected clients, this is indeed a problem that goes far beyond Glasgow, Lanarkshire and central Scotland, because more and more people across the entirety of the UK are now discovering that they may be affected. Just some of the issues that my constituents have raised are quite alarming. Stuart McMillan has mentioned them, but I'll go through them again. Assets that should have been put into family protection trusts, which weren't. Power of attorneys that have been paid for but not registered. McClure partners and staff refusing to sign documents to enable the change to land registry records without being paid for doing so. McClure taking instructions and money from potential clients up until the day it went into administration, knowing that the work would not be completed or the money returned. Wills that McClure put themselves on as executors, in many instances against the express wishes of the client. These are very serious matters, and although I cannot give legal advice as an MSP, I can say to anyone who feels that they have been affected that if you are not satisfied with anything you have experienced, with any actions from McClure's, Jones and White, or indeed any other solicitor that you have been in contact with, it is your right to make a complaint to the Scottish Legal Complaints Commission. These allegations are grave, and I welcome Police Scotland's establishment of a dedicated team to investigate these numerous complaints thoroughly. As for what we can do in this chamber, again, Stuart McMillan has mentioned it, but the Trusts and Succession Bill was passed unanimously late last year. At stage two, amendments were lodged to allow trustees to remove a trustee without going to court in an extra set of circumstances. These instances would occur when the trustee in question is no longer or entitled to practice as a member of a regulated profession. This amendment was deemed necessary after trustees from McClure's, appointed in a professional capacity, only agreed to resign in exchange for payment of a sum of money. Furthermore, Presiding Officer, the current Regulation of Legal Services Bill, which passed stage one in here last week, gives us another opportunity to ensure that situations like this cannot arise again, and this is an issue around McClure's that has come up in our committee evidence on that bill. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, I encourage a full investigation of the allegations that have been brought by those who have had dealings with McClure's in the past. I hope that all who have been affected can find a swift resolution and that this Parliament continues to legislate in order to make sure something like this can never happen again. And I want to finish by again thanking my constituents who have came to me with this issue, and like Stuart McMillan, I have every expectation that that number will continue to rise over the coming month and years as people become more aware of this issue. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr McGregor. I call Russell Finlay to be followed by Rosa Grant. Mr Finlay.
Thank you, President Officer. And I also begin by congratulating Stuart McMillan on securing this important debate and for all the significant work he's been doing on this, along with some other members, including Bob Doris. It's right that Parliament is willing to get its teeth into such a monumental scandal as McClure's. The trail of damage left by this bust law firm has harmed the interests of hundreds, if not thousands, of former clients across the UK. By no definition could these former clients be described as the wealthy. They were ordinary folk who put their trust in a high street law firm. Decent, hard-working people who took responsibility to put their affairs in order. Many are in their twilight years, in their 70s, 80s, even 90s. Most are still unaware that there might be problems with their wills, their trust deeds or other legal documents. Others have discovered discrepancies and irregularities in work carried out by McClure's, and they've been forced to fork out good money to try to put things right. But this is not always straightforward, trapping families in a state of expensive limbo, often for years. Now, when any type of business ceases trading, customers and creditors can suffer a detriment. But when a law firm goes under, the consequences can be much more far-reaching. Now, last week, I spoke in the Stage 1 debate on the legal Regulation of Legal Services Bill, as mentioned by Fulton MacGregor and Stuart McMillan already. And I think that is relevant to what we are talking about today. The system of legal regulation in Scotland is confusing, complex and costly. McClure victims might even suspect that the system was designed with the purpose of deterring complainers and protecting lawyers. It's harder to negotiate than a hall of mirrors. Now, 7 long years ago, the Scottish Government ordered a review of legal regulation. The review found that Scotland needs a single regulator, independent of the profession and of government. However, ministers chose to bin this recommendation. And astonishingly, the report author says that what's now on the table is, quote, much more complex than what already exists. Now, I want to explain a bit more about previous attempts to protect the public. In 2008, the Scottish Government created the Scottish Legal Complaints Commission. The SLCC's briefing document to MSPs about McClure's is refreshingly candid. They reveal that they can say very little about McClure's because it would be a criminal offence to disclose information even about the existence of complaints. The SLCC describes the system as, and again quoting, a complex maze that fails to protect the public from harm. They say that in recent years, the convoluted system has somehow been made even more complex and unworkable. If I've got time.
I can give you a wee bit of time back, Minister.
Thank you.
Member for taking the intervention. Does the member recognise at stage one last week the Scottish Legal Complaints Commission urged all members to support the regulation of legal services at stage one for the much-needed reform?
Russell Finlay.
I mean, the SLCC's position in respect of the regulatory framework is that they want the system of which they are a part to be changed for the better. And what is on the table, what's in the bill, does not protect the public. I mean, it's not often that a regulator admits that it's got, you know, fewer teeth than a newborn baby, but it's not their fault. It's not the SLC's fault. This is by Scottish Government design. Now, President Officer, I heard from a number of McClure's victims a few months ago in a meeting hosted by Bob Doris. They told me that the value of business paid for by McClure's clients is in the region of £120 million. We're talking huge sums of money. Yet, they say, it might cost up to £150 million to put things right. So it seems to be a win-win for the lawyers, just not so good for the clients. Now, as for McClure's, I agree wholeheartedly with Stuart McMillan and think that first and foremost, victims should receive swift redress and then some form of inquiry may be required. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Finlay. I call Rhoda Grant to be followed by Bob Doris. Ms. Grant.
Can I too thank Stuart McMillan for securing this debate, and can I also pay tribute to the victims of McClure's Action Group for pushing for justice, and Bob Doris hosted them in the Parliament last November. And I know other colleagues have been active on this too, because many of us have had constituents that have been affected, and indeed the Delegate Powers and Law Reform Committee also used some of the lessons from this to amend the Trusts and Successions Bill. But sadly, action has been far too slow. James White has not advised everyone involved, and I wonder, should the Scottish Legal Complaints Commission or indeed the Scottish Law Society step in and take the lead in warning people to reassess their trusts and wills that were set up by McClure's, because those people need to be told now that they could be impacted. Yes.
Stuart Millen.
Thank Rhoda Grant for taking the intervention. Jones and White they told me that the reason why they haven't contacted everyone so far is particularly because of the trusts, which are a lot more complicated as compared to wills and powers of attorney, that they're focusing on them in the first instance before then going to the powers of attorney and wills.
Roger Grant.
I'm grateful for that intervention, but I think people still need to know, because this is happening under the radar and many, many more people will be impacted. And while I understand that James White have a lot of work to do, I find them difficult to deal with, certainly acting on behalf of constituents. My constituents were not given access to documents until I intervened, and then they were provided in a way that was very difficult for elderly people to deal with. Also, Police Scotland have only stepped forward now to act, but I'm glad they are stepping in because previously they had told victims that this was a civil matter. So people in this situation need to have help and advice.
Professor Finlay.
Her expertise and knowledge of these cases has seen anything that might suggest any criminality in respect of the McClure scandal.
Well, there are certainly a lot of things that don't seem right to me and need an explanation and need an investigation. Whether there's criminality or just very poor practice, who knows? But we won't know until we get someone to investigate, because these documents are complex and you need to try and follow what was being carried out. And we need to make sure that there are people there to provide that help and advice to the victims. And we should also be asking the question, should indeed any solicitor involved in drawing up a trust deed be involved in the trust themselves? We have to remember it's elderly people involved, so the people that drew up the trust deeds are elderly themselves and probably maybe don't remember doing that. But some of the people that are looking and trying to manage their affairs once they're gone are also elderly, and that causes great difficulties. We hear of people suffering bereavement, having to deal with those barriers and hurdles, and we've also heard about houses getting caught up, lying empty for years and becoming a drain on the finances of family left behind or expected to maintain properties while they have no access to them. So I disagree with Stuart McMillan on this one point. I think the investigation has to happen now, because I believe people are not getting the support they need right now and will never be compensated unless there is an investigation, because they're being turned away by the Scottish Legal Complaints Commission, who won't deal with that. And I think we need to find somebody who is independent of all of this that will go through those, that the victims can actually speak to and have their cases reviewed, because there are many thousands of other people that are affected and totally unaware of this as well. So, just in conclusion, Presiding Officer, we need to make sure people are warned. We need an investigation to help those that are affected and to make sure that that investigation also leads to the closing of loopholes. And we need to ensure that every victim is compensated and nobody is turned away.
Thank you, Ms Grant. I call Bob Dorris to be followed by Claire Hoggy. Mr Dorris.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I was already aware of the issues surrounding the collapse of McClure Solicitors. I was aware of the emergence of incompetent or unscrupulous practices from McClure's solicitors following their collapse and the significant impact on many thousands of clients. That was mainly due to the diligent work of my colleague Stuart McMillan, MSP. He's championed the victims of McClure's. For other MSPs, the scandal's been a bit of a slow burner. It's only been in recent months that my constituents have started to step forward and give voice to the impact on them over the incompetence of McClure's. To be honest, some are unsure as to what is incompetence, what is negligence, and what is misconduct. And when does systematic misconduct transfer over to potential criminality? It's all a bit unclear. I'm not saying that is the case, but if that was the case, that would be on an industrial scale, from what I can gather. Now, when a loved one passes, sorting out the financial affairs of a deceased, perhaps your mum or dad should be the least that a grieving relative has to worry about. One of the reasons families make sure there's wills set up, there's family protection trusts set up, is to provide certainty in such circumstances. McClure's provided anything but that. My constituents point to family trusts not being set up properly. Indeed, as we've heard here this evening, sometimes not at all. Concerns that often only come to light when a loved one dies. Concerns over how Jones White solicitors, who took possession of the McClure's client cases, are handling their responsibilities regarding delays in informing families and in charging, is what's put to me, exorbitant fees. I absolutely accept the
huge complex workload that there is there for Jones White. But I'm also aware there's a whole variety of insurance schemes that exist. And I think when something like McClure's happens, the money should be drawn down through these insurance companies to get that additional resource that this matter's resolved promptly. It's not enough to say we simply don't have the resource to do this swiftly and speedily. That's really not acceptable. There have been concerns over solicitors named as professional trustees and family trusts charging inappropriate fees when families seek to have their names removed. For the avoidance of doubt, that would be a solicitor who is potentially responsible for setting up the flawed or inappropriate family trust in the first place, who may now be charging families to remedy their own incompetence. One family described that to me as simply brazen.
Stuart McMillan.
Thank Bob Dodds for the intervention, but Bob agreed with me that although it's legal, but morally, it's something that certainly leaves a sour taste in the mouth, and would agree with me that that those individuals should actually not charge going forward.
Bob Dodds.
Can I say to Mr McMillan, I agree with every word of that, so thank you for putting that on the record. I associate myself with those comments. I mentioned that the McClure's debacle is a slow burner. I think the cases in Glasgow are the tip of an iceberg. We've all got a responsibility to publicise this. Maybe Glasgow Evening Times should run a campaign, say, step forward, have you been a victim of McClure's? We need to know. We have to get to the bottom of this. But it will take years to understand the true extent. But can I just say briefly, always advise our constituents, or anyone listening out there, always go to the SLCC in the first instance, because one of the things I found out about the event that I held in the Scottish Parliament is people don't always go to the right body to seek assistance. I'm not saying it will resolve everything, but always go to the Scottish Legal Complaints Commission. So I was saying about where a pattern of incompetence or misconduct has or has not been identified, and I asked the Law Society of Scotland about that and the Scottish Legal Complaints Commission. To be fair, they want more power to be able to say publicly the patterns that they are seeing emerge from their casework. But what I'm unclear about is whether or not there could be a bit of a standoff between Police Scotland and the Law Society of Scotland about whose responsibility it is to be clear about where criminality may be at play. I suspect, Mr McMillan, this is the start of a long campaign that you will champion. And today, this afternoon, I think you've got a lot of MSPs in solidarity with you to push forward for justice for the victims of McClure's.
Thank you, Mr Torres. I call Claire Hockey to be followed by Audrey Nicholl. Ms Hockey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I would like to add my thanks to Stuart McMillan on securing today's debate on McClure solicitors and the fallout since they ceased trading in 2021. And I also want to thank his constituency team, who I know my office staff have been in touch with seeking advice on some issues. And I want to thank Bob Dorris, as well as members of the Victims of McClure's campaign group, for a meeting that was hosted in Parliament on this subject in November last year. Presiding Officer, it was clear from the testimonies of the campaign group and the growing number of my constituents who have raised this with me just how wide-ranging and serious the issues McClure's former clients are now experiencing. And this one company's actions have impacted an estimated 100,000 people right across the whole of the UK, a potentially significant number unaware that their wills, trusts and other legal affairs may not be in order. And I have heard of former clients of McClure's who have been reportedly struggling to sell their homes, former clients who had allegedly paid McClure's to put their properties in trust or to set up a power of attorney before subsequently learning this never happened, as well as people having to pay thousands of pounds on further legal fees to try and resolve some of the issues they're experiencing since McClure's went bust. According to the Action Group, many of those are people in their 70s and older. Some have sadly passed away, and it's their families that are trying to sort out this mess now. Presiding Officer, over the past couple of months, I've been in frequent contact with the Law Society of Scotland and Jones White. Jones White took over the goodwill, work in progress and certain assets of McClure's when it ceased trading practice. And the Law Society of Scotland has been very clear in that it expects Jones White to write to each client, giving priority to the most urgent cases with ongoing work. However, not everyone has been contacted.
And at the briefing in November, I understand the campaign group estimated around 90,000 people still weren't aware McClure's had ceased trading. I therefore continue to urge Jones White to notify all clients in a timely manner and will remain in contact with the Law Society to ensure their expectation that all clients are written to is realised. In the meantime, however, I hope today's debate will help to increase public awareness of the demise of McClure's, and I'll be doing what I can to spread the word within my own Rutherglen constituency. Presiding Officer, I hope any of the constituents who are impacted with Jones White regarding their documents and consider making a complaint to the Scottish Legal Complaints Commission if they deem that that is appropriate. SLCC is the gateway for all complaints about solicitors in Scotland, and they can award compensation if they uphold a complaint. And I know from the briefing that concerns have been raised about SLCC's capacity to handle a significant number of complaints, particularly as the awareness of this issue grows. Although SLCC is funded by a levy paid by legal professionals, not by the public purse, I hope their capacity and ability to handle increased numbers of complaints can be monitored. Presiding Officer, for me, there are three key areas that need attention, that everyone who's impacted must be made aware. Individuals should be signposted into making complaints if they deem that necessary, and that there should be a formal inquiry to thoroughly examine all aspects of the McClure's conduct, its collapse and subsequent events. And on that last point, that is certainly something that has been raised with me by my own constituents, and I'm aware that police have recently confirmed that they are looking into this. In closing, Presiding Officer, everyone caught up in this deserves our full support, and I know that Stuart McMillan will continue his campaign seeking answers and remedies, and I'd like to reassure my constituents that I'll be doing what I can to assist them too. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Hockey. I call Audrey Nicholl to be followed by Marie McNair.
Thank you. Can I also thank my colleague Stuart McMillan for bringing forward this motion for debate. The level of interest in the impact of the failure and administration of McClure solicitors speaks for itself. And I know Stuart McMillan and his constituency team have worked tirelessly to respond to those impacted who've contacted his office and others seeking help. And my heart really goes out to those affected who are likely to find that the investigation and legal complaints process arising from this failure will be lengthy and not straightforward. And I want to highlight one case reported to me by constituents who, like many others, were completely unaware of the demise of McClure's and found out completely by accident. My constituents approached McClure's to put arrangements in place for a simple family protection trust, and it was quite by chance that they discovered McClure's had gone into administration. And despite the range of support offered by the Law Society, the Scottish Legal Complaints Commission, and others, my constituents have remarkably found the most reliable source of advice for them has been a Facebook page. So they have now placed their affairs in the hands of a local solicitor. However, while doing so, they've discovered discrepancies in the handling of their trust by McClure's that have caused them considerable stress and uncertainty, and they are now out of pocket. And while I hope those charged with addressing the failings by McClure's will seek to assist clients back to a position where there is no loss or disadvantage, this is by no means guaranteed. And I am reassured to hear other members' engagement with bodies such as the Law Society has been positive. And of course, the timing of this debate coincides with last week's debate on the Regulation of Legal Services Bill, which other members have highlighted. And regulation has been a controversial subject with two distinct strands. Those who consider the current system favours solicitors and does not benefit consumers, and those who take the view that the current system does provide high-quality legal services and that the independence of the judiciary from government must be preserved. Now, several members during that debate spoke powerfully and articulated the frankly appalling way that the legal profession had treated persons who had sought help from them. And as one member put it, there is little that is more corrosive than suffering and injustice, and it is even worse when that injustice is caused by the justice system. Another member highlighted that 18 years on from the unsuccessful Legal Profession and Legal Aid Scotland Bill, significant concerns remain about the conduct of some elements of the legal profession and that there is a lack of confidence in current arrangements to adequately protect the consumer interest. Very brief one.
Russell Finlay.
First of all, I thank the member for the quotation, but I'd like to ask, as a former police officer, whether the member has seen anything so far that might constitute criminality in respect of McClure's.
Audrey Nicholl.
I've not scrutinised this particular case closely enough to be able to remotely be able to pass an opinion on that. So in the meantime, as we await the continued passage of the bill through the parliamentary process that I hope will underpin good law that will protect the public and prevent this type of situation arising again, our constituents wait patiently. But I want to finish by highlighting two areas of practice that in my mind must be in place if they are not already. Firstly, client-based details must be accessible to those overseeing the transfer of business, with clients contacted at an early stage to advise them their chosen legal advisers have ceased trading and their business will be transferred to another nominated company, or if they wish, one of their choosing. Such contact must progress at pace following the collapse of any solicitor's business. And secondly, it's crucial that when clients are advised of the circumstances of a change, resources are directed to ensure all work instructed was completed correctly and that no issues remain outstanding. So, Presiding Officer, to conclude, I fully support the work of Stuart McMillan and his debate, and I would also urge constituents in my constituency of Aberdeen South and North Kincardine to get in touch with me at any time should they feel that they may have been affected. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Nicholl. And I call Marie McNair. Ms McNair.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I firstly thank my colleague Stuart McMillan for securing this highly important debate? I know he's done a lot of work in this regard to support his constituents and raise awareness, and I thank him for this. I speak in this debate on behalf of several constituents who have been affected by McClure's, and as mentioned, it's estimated that around 100,000 people have been impacted by this scandal across the UK. The clients are predominantly elderly and in some cases also vulnerable. Many who were impacted were advised a new will was beneficial and later sold family protection trusts and power of attorneys on the back of this. The cost of this was in the thousands, money which the clients had worked hard for over their lives and which they couldn't afford to lose. And since been taken over by Jones White, it is believed files have been passed over without the express permission of clients themselves. And this is a cause for concern among some constituents. With McClure's now in administration, thousands of people are left with significant difficulties in accessing assets because of the numerous inaccuracies or failings by McClure's, and this has caused undue stress, anxiety and financial difficulty for clients and their surviving families, who are often now having to pay extra to remedy these failings, and that is a disgrace. One of my constituents who gave permission for me to share their story told me this. I paid McClure's to prepare a will and power of attorney for me in 2020. The power of attorney was never registered with the Office of Public Guardian. Jones White Solicitors has taken over from McClure's and said, I need to pay again. As a 75-year-old pensioner frightened to turn my heating up, I'm distressed to have to start further payments to yet another law firm. Another of my constituents said, my mother was a victim of McClure solicitors and was encouraged to put her home into a trust by a will and a power of attorney for £3,500. It was missold to her, and two of the McClure staff put themselves on the trust as trustees and also changed the title deeds of my mother's home to name herself on the deeds without her knowledge. We're now trying to unravel the mess they've made with the new solicitor, costing further expense to my retired mother. These are just two examples of several cases I've received into my office, and what links each one is the victims are elderly and some have serious health conditions as well. It's utterly unacceptable that they have been put into such a stressful financial difficulties, at a point in their life where they really should be able to relax and put their feet up. I'm backing Stuart McMillan's calls for an inquiry into the firm's conduct and subsequent collapse to prevent a reoccurrence of this situation. And unfortunately, it is expected that thousands may be unaware this has happened and that as a result, their legal affairs will not be in order. So it is vital as MSPs we do what we can to spread awareness of this in tandem with the excellent work done by the victims of McClure Solicitors campaign. If this awareness can be extended to a Scottish Government information campaign, as suggested by Stuart McMillan, this would have my backing. How we treat elderly residents says a lot about who we are as people. It says a lot about our country too. They deserve to be treated with compassion, honesty and respect, and they should not have been misled. So it is vital we do everything in our powers to support these victims as best we can, and I'm firmly on their side and alongside Stuart McMillan. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms McNair. And I call on Minister Siobhan Brown to respond to the debate. Around 7 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to thank Mr McMillan for raising this important matter and thank all those members who have spoken and raised a number of really important points. And I'd like to respond as far as I can in the time allowed. I'd like to begin by sympathising with all of those who have been adversely affected by the collapse of McClure's Solicitors. It is important that when this happens in a regulated market, there are measures put in place to protect consumers. I would encourage those affected to seek advice from the Law Society of Scotland and the Scottish Legal Complaints Commission, who can provide information and clarity on how to seek redress through raising a complaint, making a claim under the Client Protection Fund, or making a claim through the Professional Indemnity Insurance Scheme. These measures are put in place to provide consumer protection and redress where appropriate, and these schemes remain a route to redress when a legal firm has gone into administration. The Government has also taken proactive steps to strengthen the legislation in respect of both legal regulation and trust, which will help to mitigate against such a situation happening in the future. Presiding Officer, cases like McClure's Solicitors show the need for legal regulation that centres on the public interest and the protection of the consumer. Yes, I will.
Russell Findlay.
I just wonder what the Minister's response is to Esther Robertson's take that what's being proposed in the bill makes the regulatory framework even more complex.
Minister.
I think we went through the history of the independent regulator in the Stage 1 last week, and I think when I watched Esther Robertson in the committee, she did acknowledge that there was a divide and a very polarised view, which would be very, very difficult to try and get everybody on board, and that's why the compromise in Stage 1 moving forward. Presiding Officer, cases such as McClure Solicitors show the need for legal regulation that centres on the public interest and protection of the consumer. That is what the Regulation of Legal Services Scotland Bill, which passed at Stage 1 last week, seeks to achieve. The current legal framework places the emphasis on regulating the individual solicitor rather than the law firm that they are employed by. In a significant shift for legal services regulation, the bill introduces a requirement for all legal businesses to be regulated as entities. This new system of entity regulation will bring greater oversight and monitoring of legal businesses. It will introduce a requirement for all legal businesses to be authorised to provide legal services and place public and consumer interests at its heart. This will allow for the Law Society to review a business performance to ensure it is complying with its duties to clients and that it is financially sustainable. The regulator will be able to direct changes and impose sanctions when there is non-compliance. Entity regulation will also introduce greater consistency in how legal firms are regulated, with all entities having to meet the same high standards. A greater ability to collate data will help the Law Society to identify and address deficiencies early and take the necessary preventative action. The bill extends regulatory complaints to cover those legal entities intended to allow a mechanism to address a systematic issue in a legal firm. The bill sets out the regulatory objectives, which must be compiled with its legal regulators exercise their function, including consideration of the consumer principles, the better regulation principles, and the human rights principles. It will streamline the legal complaint system, which many stakeholders have called for, making the process faster, simpler, for the consumers and legal practitioners who find themselves involved in it, such as those who have all been affected by McClure's. If there is any concern that a legal regulator is failing in its duties, the bill will introduce an ability for the regulator's performers to be reviewed and measures taken to ensure improvements are made where necessary. Presiding Officer, during the parliamentary passage of the Trust and Succession Scotland Bill last year, we learnt about the fallout of the failure of McClure's solicitors and the impact it had on existing trusts. And I'd like to thank Stuart McMillan, who as convener of the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee, led scrutiny of the bill and ensured that the matter of McClure's in the context of trusts was fully considered. The Act made a number of important changes to how trusts are administered and how trustees are appointed and removed, and Parliament was able to make amendments at stages 2 and 3 to respond to the significant practical difficulties that co-trustees may have in removing a trustee who was appointed as a trustee in the professional capacity and is no longer a member of the profession. If I may highlight a few of the issues that have been raised, Presiding Officer, I appreciate the need to raise public awareness into the public domain about McClure's. And when McClure's ceased training, the Law Society published notifications on their website to flag the situation, and the goodwill and the work in progress and certain assets has been taken over, as we know from Jones White. But it is now the responsibility of the acquiring firm to contact the former clients of McClure's. And this process is ongoing, and due to the large number of people affected, Jones White has indicated that it's prioritising cases which needs immediate attention and continues to inform all clients. Just... Yes.
Bob Doris.
So, thank you, Ms, for giving way. I'm just wondering how that's resourced by the acquiring firm. The Minister was talking about various insurance schemes that can pay out in relation to various matters. If this is an issue of resource, surely they should be drawn upon and it should be resourced. It should be a matter of course that all clients are advised on the collapse of the firm and their cases are reviewed without a single penny being cost to that client.
Minister.
Yes, I can appreciate that. There is no specific legal duty for Jones White to contact the clients, and there is a risk of legislative changes that would not be appropriate for individual situations and could act as a deterrent in the future to prevent any future legal firm stepping in to take over a case and files of another legal firm that's gone into administration in such a situation, which could be detrimental to the clients involved. But I acknowledge the point made by the member. If I could just delicately just raise one thing about police involvement. I'm aware that it has been reported to Police Scotland and has met with those affected, and I understand Police Scotland has commented that an assessment of the information is ongoing. Therefore, as Minister, it would be inappropriate for me to comment further, and I would just caution elected members to state that there's any criminality happen. Claire Hockey brought up the concerns regarding the workload of SLCC, and she's quite right to do that, and as she said, that it is funded by a levy paid by legal professions in Scotland. I meet regularly with the SLCC, and any proposed levy taking into consideration any increases in complaints, such as the complaints relating to this matter, and the... Yes.
Roger Grant.
And I understand she doesn't have the answers to everything. The police are looking at this, SLCC are looking at it. But does she have any advice for my constituent who is getting nowhere with the SLCC? And it's very clear to me, who doesn't have a legal background and I'm not in a position to advise her, that there are unanswered questions and indeed things that don't look right to me. What assistance can my constituent get to get to the bottom of this so that she's satisfied that her relatives' wishes have been put into action and that they haven't lost out?
Minister. Of course, I can. I would advise to get in touch with the SLCC, but if your constituent is not getting anywhere, I don't know the personal circumstances. If a member would like to write to me and I could look into it on her behalf. If I may, Presiding Officer, calls for an inquiry. So the priority at the moment is to find a solution for those who have been adversely affected by this, and it is an ongoing regulatory matter. An inquiry would not provide practical help to any of those who have been adversely affected at this stage, and accordingly I would not support establishing an inquiry at this stage. The Scottish Government will continue to monitor the situation alongside the regulatory authorities, and the calls from Stuart McMillan and Marie McNair regarding information campaign by the Scottish Government. I'm aware of the asks for the Scottish Government to consider initiating an information campaign to raise awareness amongst the former clients who may not yet be informed about the situation. This is a matter for the Law Society of Scotland as a regulatory body, and I understand that legal firm Jones White took on McClure's files and are engaging with those affected. Presiding Officer, the priority in respect of McClure's is to find a solution for those who may have been adversely affected, and I would encourage those who have any concerns to seek advice from the Law Society or the Scottish Legal Complaints Commission. As an ongoing regulatory matter, the overall responsibility for the regulation of the solicitor profession rests with our primary regulators, which are the Law Society of Scotland and the Lord President. The Law Society have written to me today to advise that an independent regulatory committee is taking proactive action and intends to bring in new practice rules and additional guidance, principally in relation to the obligations and the expectations, including communications, when a solicitor or practice makes arrangements to pass client assets to another. So that's just happened today, and there will be more information coming to MSPs in that regard. The Scottish Government will, of course, continue to monitor the situation alongside the regulatory authorities. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting.